Greetings. Welcome to the Hypercast, Hyperic's bi-weekly series of educational webcasts focused on Hyperic HQ and enterprise systems management best practices. My name is John Travis, and I'm the principal engineer for Hyperic. I'm joined today by Mary McGarry, and she is our tech writer. Today is to basically go through a simple plugin and just kind of talk about where information can be obtained, kind of some of the things that HQU plugins can do, and the process that I go through and other people go through here at Hyperic to develop plugins. This slide is one that we showed for the previous HQU framework discussion and outlines the three major points of the plugin framework. The first one is that you're able to develop custom UI views. In this section, we're going to develop a custom view that allows you to enter in log tracking information manually. And it's integrated inside of the rest of the HQ portal. Another type of integration is the web services integration, which will allow you to integrate HQ with other software. And finally, the Groovy Script Console, which provides an easy way to perform automation tasks or interact with the HQ backend. We'll be using the Groovy Script Console a little bit today to help develop our plugin. If you'd like to follow along or want more information, the HQUplugins.org site is the place to currently get the documentation. There is a document that Marie has developed, which I will show later on in the session, which has a much more full, rich documentation and information to kind of start to finish. All right, so the first thing we're going to go ahead and do is share the desktop. Is he ready to go? So this is just a basic installation of HQ, the .org version 3.2.3. So all the things that I'm showing you today are available to you in 3.2.3. Should take about 10 to 15 minutes to go through this development. And okay. So the goal of the plugin that we're going to do today is one that allows us to enter in log tracking information manually. So typically, administrators are able to look at this page here and see the indicators page, see which events have occurred for a resource during a given time interval. But all of these events are things that are generated via the plugins. In this case, the system plugin is telling me that the HQ demo user logged in at 10:41. But say there was some additional piece of log information that I wanted to keep track of. Say that I wanted to note, for instance, that this platform, I recently killed off a lot of processes, which should free up some CPU time. There's no real good way to capture that as an event log manually. In the past, you've been able to do things like write these messages into a log file and have HQ pick them up. But today we're going to actually develop a little bit of UI that allows you to create the log events right in the UI. So one of the things about HQU that might be difficult for some people just starting out is that they may not be aware of, you know, all the stuff that's in the back end, all the code that's, you know, all the APIs that are currently out there in the HQU framework, as well as the HQ backend framework. And this is something that we're working on making better documentation for, but it's something that, you know, just like any other piece of software, you'll have to kind of get used to initially. So the first thing we're going to do is trying to figure out how to create event logs. And we're going to actually try and use the Groovy console to do this. It's nice to often use the Groovy console to flesh out ideas before actually going in and coding a plugin. So we'll go to the administration screen, and the Groovy console is listed down here under plugins. As you can see, I have a lot of templates already defined. These are just ones that I use as a developer, and people using the software as administrators often can put their templates here for things that they frequently do. In this case, I'm going to load up a template that is used that I use to do some permission checking tests. But I'm going to scrap most of it and just use some of the stuff at the top. If I execute this, Groovy spits out the result, which is that it found that platform, since I only have one platform there, and I'm finding it by ID up here. A number of these functions and such may not be that useful to you immediately. In the actual plugin, HQU plugins, some of these things are made a little bit easier, like the ability to get the current user and the resource that you're currently viewing. So that's something that I'll show you here in a little bit. But for right now, this is kind of the easiest way to get that information. Okay, so we're going to create a log tracking event. There's a few classes that we'll need to do that with. The first one is the resource log event. Basically, this ties an event to an actual resource. So we'll go ahead and import that. We'll also need to declare which log levels we're going to be using. So those constants are defined elsewhere. And we'll actually need to go ahead and create the event itself. And finally, and most importantly, we're going to need the event log manager. So if you're not familiar with how HQ backends APIs are laid out, the manager classes are the session beans that contain most of the logic needed to, if you're looking at a platform manager, that will usually have all the methods that you need to create or delete or modify platforms. If you're looking at escalation manager, that will have code to do things like create escalations or invoke them, etc. So in this case, we're going to import those things. We'll hit the execute button just to make sure I didn't typo anything. Okay, everything looks fine. So let's go ahead and try and create a new event. If you're not familiar with the Groovy syntax, a lot of it's similar to Java, except you don't have to necessarily strictly type everything. And in this case, we're getting a handle on our event manager class. And we'll create a new event. And we'll use the platform's ID. So if that just came out totally Greek, I'll go ahead and show you where that information was obtained. Okay, the AppDef entity ID is the way that nearly all of the AppDef objects or application definition objects are identified. An AppDef entity ID can equate to a platform, server, service, application, or group. Each one of those has an AppDef entity ID, so that's how they're tied. So in this case, I've created one for now with a log level defined as a constant from the log track plugin and the source. Okay, so we've created the track event, and the result seems to have worked. But this thing is not actually persisted. This is just a transient object that could be passed around. In order to actually persist it, we're going to need to make an actual resource log event and tell the event manager that we want to save it. Uh, Okay, so as soon as we have the event, we can go ahead and ask the event manager to save it. In this case, I'll go ahead and show the event manager code. Here's the documentation for actually creating an event log. Resource track event, it extends abstract event, and then this other information is fairly clear. So we'll ask the event manager to do it. Return new event log. Okay. In order to actually see that it actually did something, let's go ahead and check it out. So we browse to that platform and we'll see that there's a blue box down here that represents the work that we just did. All right, so now that we've got a little bit of a skeleton for the code that we want to use to create log events, we need to go ahead and start creating a UI plugin for it. In this case, we want to allow users to go to the Views tab and use the context that they're already in, i.e., they're already in the context of a platform, so we want to use this context to our advantage and create a plugin that already is working within that framework. So in this case, we already have a view called Live Exec. For those of you who have not seen a Live Exec, this is able to work on platforms or groups of platforms and able to execute kind of Unix-style commands using the cigar library cross-platform. In this case, we're able to get disk usage, whatever. What we'd really like to see is a new plugin here that allows us to type in log messages and have them represented in the platform. So what we'll use there is the scaffolding framework. HQU comes with a scaffolding framework that basically creates a skeleton plugin that's pretty much ready to go. If you use the HQU gen scaffold command, it'll give you some more information about the requirements. Okay, so in this case, let's call the plugin impact. This will be our impact plugin that we'll use to log information about the impact of doing things like killing off a number of processes, which should free up some CPU. So we'll have the plugin called impact, and the controller, which is the controller in an MVC style framework, be called log controller. Okay, the reason that there's a controller and a controller is one of them's uppercase and one of them's lowercase. This is an artifact of how things are done through Ant right now. It's not the optimal way. The documentation should make this a little bit more clear. So once we execute this command, it goes ahead and copies a few files into place and tells you actually how to deploy it in HQ and see the effect of what you're doing right away. So let's actually just go ahead and do that. Actually, before we do that, it creates the plugin in UI plugins impact, but I want to, and here's the file that it's created for me already, the skeleton. But in this case, I'm going to actually change this plugin.groovy, which is the main file that HQ uses to interact with your plugin. By default, it's able to set up a view, create all this stuff, and by default, it's actually commented out so that it doesn't actually add any views to the application. If this were to actually be uncommented, we would just have a new item in the masthead called a groovy HQU impact. But we're going to do a little bit better than that. We're going to actually go ahead and get it integrated into the Views tab for the resources. We're going to have this be attached to all platforms. The documentation for the plugin.ruby should contain all this information. The controller argument lets us point at a specific controller. So when the view within the context of the platform is rendered, it's going to actually call into the log controller and render the action identified by index. Okay, so that's done. And now we'll just use the rest of the instructions to deploy the plugin. Internally, plugin deployment just removes the impact directory from the deployed JBoss, and then waits a few seconds and copies it back in. There's a there's a watcher that watches the directory to make sure things come in. So looking at our JBoss log, we're able to see the impact was redeployed. I actually don't see that. Let's see if it actually showed up, though. So it should show up here in the Views tab. It's not. Okay, there, it looks like it attached it. The watcher must have missed it last time. Okay, so here's our new plugin. If we reload the Views tab, you'll see the new plugin sitting there with all the scaffolded text, and we're basically ready to start filling in the body of the plugin. So the first thing we're going to do is go ahead and strip out all this. The first thing we could do is maybe change the description of what's labeled under the Views tab. We'll go back to our text editor and edit the localization properties file. The localization properties file defines the description that's displayed as well as if usable through the controllers and any of the views. So we'll go ahead and call this impact logger. And while we're at it, let's go ahead and actually change this index.gsp, which contains the text that was displayed that we just saw. In this case, we probably don't want most of the stuff. We would rather just maybe have an entry widget or something like that. Okay, so we'll redeploy the plugin again. Should be redeployed there. Reload our Views tab, and we see the effect of the changes in the HTML and in our View tab here. So people will be able to click the impact logger, type some message, hit submit, and hopefully there'll be a new log message. So what's the next step? The next step would probably be to start adding code that is actually able to send the event back from the web browser into the controller so that it can be pushed to the database. The way we're going to do that in this example is just to use some of the Dojo calls. HQ uses Dojo for a lot of the AJAX-style interaction. So we can use Dojo to actually send an AJAX call with the UI plugin when submit is hit to the backend controller. So what we'll do to do that is edit the GSP file, which is the view, the Groovy template. and kind of add that code there. So probably what we want to have happen is we need some script. HQU comes with some built-in methods for making new URLs. So in this case, we're able to tell Dojo, call the method called addLog on the controller. In this case, it's going to be the log controller, the one that we had just created. And this URL for method, which is available to the GSP views, just formulates that URL dynamically. And in order to give it information about what context we're writing in, we're going to also tack on this resource ID. The resource ID is something that we're going to pass in through the controller in a second. Okay, so the content is just a key value pair. When the remote end gets, when the controller receives this message from Dojo, the request, it's going to have this log parameter already filled in with whatever content we want. In this case, we probably want to, okay, so we've identified the input as log, so we'll be able to use Dojo to just pull the value to send off. And then when the data comes back, we want to call this closure. In this case, we probably want it to display some kind of status message. So let's make an additional chunk of code. Called result. That we just replace in our HTML whenever the function comes back. And okay. So the one thing remaining from this view that we didn't do anything about was this resource ID as part of the URL. We need to actually, this variable needs to get pushed into the GSP so that it can be rendered. And right now, the only way to do that is by actually editing the controller and having the controller push any variables that the GSP wants to use into its context. So we'll go ahead and edit the controller now. The controller is the main worker that receives all the requests and ends up rendering the views. So this index method gets called, and we actually call it with, here's some local variables already, actually, the plugin or the current user's name, but we want it to actually contain resource ID that's used. The base controller defines a method called getViewedResource, so we'll just use that as the entity ID that's used. And finally, we're going to be calling addLog. If you'll recall from the GSP, we added a method called addLog. It was called from Dojo. For right now, let's just go ahead and put out some debugging information. The base controller also defines the logging facilities. And we need to make it a JSON method. So we'll call JSON methods are defined as an array. And when this method returns, we'll return a message out to the client. Okay. Let's go ahead and try this iteration out. after A. Inevitable. No such property resource ID for a class script 1. Well, that means that the view is not getting the... Oh, should be. Resource ID. Debugging perhaps now. Can you spell it? We'll just change the EID. That'll do a little bit here. Okay. Exactly what happened there, but so my log message, let's see if we submit it. What should happen is on the remote side, we should be able to skip that. That's not getting it.
Great.
This is the part where I wish I had my firebug installed. Oh, I think I know what the problem is. So we created all this dojo work, but we never actually told it to call that method when we click the button. Let's go ahead and add that right now. Full round trip now. The text that we've put in the entry widget is getting sent to the server when I click the submit button. And here, when I look at the log message, it says adding log for parameters, my log message with the apt-affinity ID. Cool. So we're almost there. The final step would be to take the work that we did in the Groovy console, combine it with this work that we've done with a scaffolded HQU plugin, and finally get it in the database. So we'll go ahead and edit the controller, which is, again, where the logic is that we had put for add log. And we'll go ahead and pull some of the code that we had already put into the Groovy console straight out. So we'll copy our import statements. And we'll copy the meat of the Groovy console work. And clean it up. Okay. So the base controller already provides a number of very useful utility methods to get things like the current time or what resource you're currently viewing or helper for actually finding resources. Since we're already looking at a resource, that's already going to be done for us. So in this case, we're creating a new tracker event for the platform that we were looking at the Groovy console. Here we can just say viewed resource. Get viewed resource is a method on the base controller that gets the context, gets the viewed resource that your context is already providing. System current time millions can be replaced by now. And let's go ahead and call this an impact log. And for the log message, let's pull it out of the parameters. So params acts as a map, but since each key for an HTTP request can have multiple values, i.e. you can say ID equals 3 and ID equals 4, we only want one value out of that. In this case, so we've added a utility method called getOne. And we'll pull the log out and create the event. Okay. Okay. Let's go ahead and redeploy it and see if we're able to get okay, it looks like it did something, but let's actually go ahead and see if it did anything. If you're not familiar with the Event Center, it's a plugin that we wrote that can be downloaded from the hqplugins.org website. It has a lot of functionality similar to the Alert Center that used for events. Okay, so in this case, you can see that the details should bear out the fact that, our log message actually got put into the system. So go to that resource that we were working with. We should be able to see the blue box at the bottom should contain our log information. In this case, it does. And that's pretty much it. Anytime an administrator needs to add new information, he can just go to this plugin. Add a new log event. And just see it in the event log. Alright, that pretty much wraps up the demo, and I think we'll go ahead and open it up to questions and such. Okay, I'll go ahead and open up the line, and
the conference is no longer in listen-only mode.
Anyone who wants to ask a question can do so now. From the chat, this one question is, will this code or walkthrough be available for public consumption? I can actually make this code available on the hqplugins.org forge. I think that it would probably be useful for people to actually be able to see an example, a working example that uses Dojo to make AJAX requests for putting log files in. I think that will be useful. So we can expect to see that on HQU plugins later today. I'd also like to go through a little bit of the documentation that Marie's been making, at least an outline. This will be available sometime within the next week. Sometime within a week or so, and we'll be posting that information on the forums when it becomes available. I'd like to go through over some of the overview, or Marie, if you'd like to go through the overview.
Sure. This is Marie. I'm the new writer in town. I've been with Hyperic since the end of March. This is one of my first efforts, and it's a work in progress. It's intended for the HQU developer, and it's based on John's developer documentation. I've tried to strive to provide different levels of information depending on what you're interested in. The goal of the document is to make it easy to find what you need without making you read stuff that you don't need. As I say, it's a work in progress. We're planning on doing enhancements that will include more information about how to deal with the APIs. John, if you want to go to the table of contents,
where is that?
You would want to go back a couple pages. Go up, go back. Oh, too far. So there's an overview. HQU overview is basically information about what can you accomplish with the HQU framework, what are the types of plugins you can develop. The other section is kind of a next section, HQU anatomy and components. Tries to describe the design pattern, refers to the design pattern that the framework complies with, and highlights what are the moving parts of a plugin. There's a not very detailed section yet that's intended to help the new developer sort of think through the process of planning plugin functionality and then mapping it to the rest of the documentation so you can see which topics are appropriate to your particular needs. There's a chapter that intends to be an overview of the process, kind of walk you through something like what John did today. Based on what I saw John do today, I expect I'll probably be making some updates in that section. We hope to, and my goal is to enhance the documentation so that it provides real examples of going through the process of creating a particular plugin, though perhaps we'll link to the VCast from it. So we're in the process of fleshing in the content. This document will be posted on the support site probably within a week, and there'll be an announcement on the forum. We very much welcome your input of any sort. Hopefully the document won't be ridden with errors. If you find them, please report them. If you find the document difficult to use, or you're kind of confused by, you know, why are they telling us this, that's the sort of information that will be very helpful in making the document as useful as possible for the plugin developer. So look on the forums for information about when we publish the guide, and please remember to provide feedback. We will take it into account.
All right, I guess that's it for us. Thank you for joining us in the Hypercast, and we'll see you next time.